Thank you all so much for coming. Thank you, Dr. Roback Morse, and the Ruth Institute for having me, and for hosting such a critically important event. Thank you to the other presenters also, and everyone who is involved, who are heeding God's call to fight for the family. You are truly the salt of the earth, preserving what is good, what is true, and what is beautiful. A special shout out to my very patient and loving husband, Matt. I hope he's watching out there. To our four sons, to Natalie and Megan, and my friend Jeannie at home, who is also a warrior in this battle. Also, I cannot forget my primal loss posse.
Peace.
My kids are home right now going, oh, my mom is such a boomer. Oh, God. That's so embarrassing. Sorry, guys. If I didn't exist, you wouldn't either. So. So let me preface my talk by saying this. I am nobody important. I have no ministry. I have no nonprofit organization. I have no books. I have no great achievements. I am a wife, a mother, an almost grandmother. And thank you. I'm a nurse, I'm a neighbor, I'm a friend. But at my core, I am a child of God. I want to share my story not to garner sympathy, but to bear witness to the grave damage inflicted on so many children through the sexual revolution, divorce, and the family courts. But more importantly, I want to convey the truth that God's grace is sufficient, and there is always, always hope when you put your trust in Him. Also, let me say, I love and have long forgiven my parents for their parts in fracturing my family. And now on to the not-so-nice stuff. It was 1972, and I was 8 years old. It was, by best estimate, about 2 o'clock in the morning. I was sitting outside in the backyard of our family home in Arizona, next to our swimming pool that had grown swamp-like with copious algae. Our cat, who had probably mistaken the stagnant water as a solid surface, was floating lifeless within it. No adult apparently willing or able to save me from such a sight. I was sitting at the feet of my mother, desperately trying to talk her out of killing herself. Not only did I feel I was on my own, but I was convinced that I was responsible for the well-being of those who should have been ensuring my well-being. I felt as if I was free-falling in darkness. Just 3 years earlier, my family had excitedly moved into our nice new house in our small desert town, a house with a sparkling swimming pool, no less. I remember the day we moved in. My father brought in our big console TV. Those of you in the late 60s and 70s remember the big console TV. It was a status symbol, right? He brought it in as we were moving in. He plugged it in, and we were able to watch the footage of the first moonwalk, which was awesome. It was such a good time. It was a time of excitement and anticipation. That's how I remember it. Just 3 short years later, I found myself in a mental and emotional free fall, no safety net to be found. My entire foundation had crumbled, and I was reeling. I was floundering. I was experiencing a deep internal dread that I can only describe as a black hole in my core. Its gravitational pull stronger than anything else around it. All light, all hope, all matter was being pulled into it. I now recognize that feeling as anxiety, and it became a near constant companion in my life after that. I'm feeling it a little bit right now, to be honest with you. Not long after we had moved into our new house, fueled by the lies of women's lib and way too much alcohol, my mom decided that marriage to my father, himself a very flawed, egocentric, alcohol-abusing man, was not worth fighting for, despite the fact they had 5 children. I remember the day I first heard the word divorce. I was 5, and I was playing in our den. My oldest sister, Claudia, who was 13 at the time, came into the room and sat down with me. She said, "Mama and Daddy are getting a divorce." Except she said it like this. "Mom and Daddy are getting a divorce. Mom and Daddy, Mom and Daddy." It was always said as one word, Mom and Daddy. "Mom and Daddy are going to the store." "Be quiet, Mom and Daddy are watching Masterpiece Theater." "I'm gonna tell Mama and Daddy." It was always one word. Honestly, I said it and felt it as if it was one word. I saw them as one inseparable entity. Even young children seem to get the concept that marriage joins a man and a woman as one flesh. And now my sister's telling me that they're divorcing. At that age, I didn't even know what a divorce was. My sister had to explain it to me. She said, it's when a mama and daddy don't love each other anymore and they don't want to live together in the same house. I can honestly say that that was the first time I experienced the interior black hole. I felt like I was free falling in darkness. I'm gonna get a drink because I'm not running for office and I think it's safe for me to take a drink from a water bottle. Soon after, my father moved out and my mother's boyfriend moved in. My parents both remarried. The time that follows is such a blur in my mind, with dysfunction figuring very prominently. There were drugs, alcohol, chaos, violent booze-fueled fights between my mother and stepfather. My siblings and I were reeling. Everything we had ever known was gone. Like that, it was gone. My family was forever fractured, and I felt like I was free-falling in darkness. When I was 7 and in the second grade, my mother always picked me up after school. One particular day, nobody came. I waited by the parking lot with my teacher. She finally had to leave, so she took me up to the principal's office to wait. My mother came 2 hours later. When we got to the car, there was a strange man in the front seat. It turns out that he was a hitchhiker that my mother had picked up. They had gotten drunk together, and she had lost track of time. And I was free-falling in darkness. During a weekend visit with my father, I was riding in the front seat of the car between my father and stepmother. I saw my mother's car coming in the opposite direction. We lived in a very small town in Arizona, and I recognized her car. I was so excited. I went to wave at her, and simultaneously, my stepmother flipped her the bird. I'm not going to do it, but you guys get the picture. I could not believe it. She said, "Hey, we both waved," as if I would find the whole thing hilarious. I was gutted. I cried silently, and I was free-falling in darkness. By this time, I had learned that divorce is a bloody domestic war in which the children are forced to fight as soldiers on both sides. I had become a reluctant double agent. I didn't dare stick up for the parent being trashed. I didn't dare tell them that their nasty words about my parent made me feel damaged and sad and dirty. I endured. God forbid I should hurt any feelings. All this time, my parents had been embroiled in a fierce custody battle. The judge presiding over my parents' protracted custody case acted as a kind of demon Solomon. He ordered that each of us children should decide for ourselves which parent was worthy to live with. The new living arrangements would be implemented before the next school year. For valid and varying reasons, we chose to live with my father. I was 8 years old. And later that night, I was sitting outside next to our swamp-like swimming pool with my dead and decomposing cat in it, me pleading with my drunk and depressed mother not to commit suicide. It was a perfect microcosm of what our family had become. I could tell you stories like this for hours, but I believe you get the basic idea. So how important is the intact family to the well-being of children? I can speak for myself that my parents' divorce was most certainly not what was best for me and not for my poor siblings. After moving out of our family home, my mother moved 2,000 miles away with her husband. Not only did I feel utterly abandoned by her, but I was certain that I was responsible for my own abandonment. My brother and sisters have been ravaged with depression, anxiety, mental illness, substance abuse, divorces, prison, remarriages, and even death. And the damage has been handed off to the next generation. And on and on and on it goes. I was blessed beyond measure to have married a good man who led me to the Catholic Church, which I can credit beyond a shadow of a doubt with saving our marriage and children from the dung heap of a broken home. But don't get me wrong, we have had our hardships. I was laden with heavy baggage, baggage that was not my husband's. He had no part in it, but he was forced to carry it with me. Thanks be to God that he understood that. He understood that's what marriage is. I, on the other hand, had absolutely no model of what marriage should be. I believed marriage was about happiness, about what my husband could do for me, how he could complete me and make whatever. The same thing you hear from everyone and all the movies and everything. That's what I thought. It took many years and much Catholic theology to open my eyes to the truth that Jesus himself and the church he founded are the perfect models for holy marriage. In other words, marital love is self-sacrificial. What a concept. There were dozens of times that we had had enough. We were tired, we were resentful, we were just done. We could so easily have inflicted on our four sons the damage that had been inflicted on me. But because of the church and her theology about marriage being for life, we held on. We held on through gritted teeth at times, but we held on. And then everything changed. After praying for years for my husband to become the person that I knew he was supposed to be, I began praying for my own heart to change, and it changed. It took a long time, but it changed. Everything is on God's time. My husband and I will be married 32 years in June. We're not only married, but we are rock solid. And despite having all the same family issues and sorrows and difficulties that every other family faces, we hold on together with Christ as our anchor. I'm so happy to say no matter what happens from here on out, I will never be free falling in darkness again. To conclude, I'd like to share with you some quotes I took from a Ken Burns documentary I watched recently, National Parks, America's Best Idea. I know that sounds really weird, but just listen. What could that possibly have to do with marriage and the family, you may ask? I'll let you be the judge. These quotes were all describing national parks. Wherever the words national parks appear, I'm going to replace them with marriage or the family, and I think you'll see what I mean. Frederick Law Olmsted was quoted in the documentary as having said, "With our marriages and families, the rights of posterity are more important than the desires of the present." Ken Burns himself stated, "We are often measured more by the bad times than by the good, but when we are in those bad times, that is where character is revealed. With marriage, it comes down to character. Who are you? Are you willing to sacrifice your I want for the we need? Or are you simply your own independent free agent, and this all simply a playground for your own selfish interests? If enough people do that, we are in big trouble." A scientist being interviewed said, "Families should be saved at all costs because they save us. There's something about fundamental continuity that gives us courage, the courage that allows us to develop into the best of who we can be as human beings." That's the national parks they're talking about. And the most profoundly applicable quote came from a park ranger who stated the following, "Families are safe keepers of precious memories. They are special entities set apart without commercial interests, which act as anchors for the health and well-being of our society." I could not believe the parallels. I was absolutely flabbergasted. I had to rewind 1,000 times and write them all down, because apparently I don't know how to use technology that well. My kids are out there going, "Boomer, boomer, oh my gosh, such a boomer." As I was preparing for this talk and my trip to Lake Charles, I had a disquiet in my spirit. I couldn't shake it. Yesterday, as I was making some edits to my talk, it dawned on me. My mother may watch the footage of this or the live stream. I needed to tell her what I was doing and make it clear that I have no lingering anger or blame for her. So I called her and I told her everything. I told her of my travel, of being invited to speak, to tell our family's story, and I wanted her to know that I have long forgiven her and my father. My mother is a living monument to the grace of God. She is now a woman of great faith and devotion to our Lord. She said, "Honey, there was a time when hearing those things would have crushed me, but I believe the words St. Paul wrote, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old things have passed away. Behold, all things are new." She went on to say, If my miserable past can open someone's eyes and save the children, save children from what you went through and what I did to you, I wholeheartedly approve. Friends, His grace is truly, truly sufficient. Thank you.